All right, guys, welcome back to Crawford Farms Entertainment. Today, I want to explain how a middle-aged man ends up watching cartoons or anime. So I'm going to tell you guys about my life story, how I ended up at this point where I am a fully grown man with a full-time job, kids, responsibilities, but in my spare time, I watch and converse about cartoons. So a little bit about myself. In high school, I was a decent high school athlete. I ended up winning a state title in wrestling my senior year. Got a scholarship, wrestled in college. Was an NAIA All-American my freshman year, runner-up. Then my sophomore year, I was champion. And then junior year, I placed second again. And senior year, I placed fourth. Then I went on to compete in the international circuit, placed in a few international tournaments, ended up coaching for a little while at Duke University, and now I work as an assistant principal at a alternative school in Durham, North Carolina. I also train in jiu-jitsu. I am currently a purple belt, haven't trained as much as I should, and then I teach wrestling classes on the side of the jiu-jitsu studio, or jiu-jitsu gym that I train at. In addition to that, I have several years of experience in boxing, mainly because there was this one point in time where I thought I was going to go into mixed martial arts. All right, so that's a little bit about me. Now let's get into this. It started in my very, very early years as a very young man. I loved to train. I loved martial arts, right? I didn't actually know any martial arts, but I love the idea of it, and I used to love to pretend as if I knew. I actually had people convinced that I knew karate when I knew absolutely none. As far as my training at the time, it was mostly push-ups and punching into the air with terrible technique, terrible form. But I wanted to, in my mind, I wanted to be a hero. I wanted to be extraordinary. When I was young, my mother took me to watch Transformers, the movie. I was a huge Transformers fan. I loved it. And there was something about that movie. It might have been the first time that I'd ever seen such a storyline. But in this movie, Optimus Prime, the leader that we had grown accustomed to and fond of for years, ended up dying. So I hope this isn't a spoiler for you. The movie came out in the mid-80s. So I hope you've had a chance to watch it. But if not, I apologize in advance. So it's the end for these guys.
First Prime. Then Ultra Magnus, and now you.
All hope is lost. Unicron, this monster planet-eating robot, has transformed into his final form and is now laying siege to the Autobots' homeworld of Cybertron. The only person who could have stopped it would have been Optimus Prime with the Matrix of leadership. But Hot Rod, our goofy, fun-loving guy, he's actually the one who had probably caused Optimus Prime's death. He's the only one anywhere near the Matrix of leadership, and he's a loser. He's a scrub. He can't do anything. When all hope seems like it's lost, Hot Rod rises to the occasion and is able to open the Matrix of leadership. He destroys Unicron and saves the world. And there's this fantastic theme song in the background. You guys really gotta watch that movie if you haven't. But at the very end, he ended up being the leader who rose up and took Optimus Prime's place. He became a Rodimus Prime. And for me, at that moment, when this underdog, this person that nobody believed could do anything, became the leader of the Autobots, that was a huge moment for me. It was kind of like something that had been awakened in me. I wanted to be that guy. I kind of always thought of myself as the underdog. I was socially awkward. I didn't really have friends outside of my family, but I wanted to be like that Rodimus Prime, like that Hot Rod. Then a little bit later, I watched this movie called The Last Dragon. In The Last Dragon, this guy was kind of picked on. He was awkward. He was a bit of an outcast. Nobody really understood this guy. And he ends up being the hero at the very end of the movie. He saves the pretty girl and attains this higher level of training. He attained the glow. He became this superhuman being who could catch bullets with their teeth. And there was this common theme that I was starting to notice that really resonated with me. You had the underdog. They worked to attain this higher level, this higher state of being. Now, I was a kid. At 5 years old, I lived in the suburbs. We had a pretty comfortable life. My dad worked at Kennedy Space Center. Things were relatively normal, but there was some trouble that was kind of bubbling up beneath the surface. My father was into some illegal activities. So he ended up running from the law. As he was running, we moved from this really nice neighborhood in Central Florida. We moved all the way down to South Florida in a neighborhood that wasn't quite as nice. So when we moved, I used to get into fights constantly. I was even more socially awkward. All right, so I remember one time in elementary school, you know, in elementary school, you get to sometimes dress up like your favorite characters. Well, I had gotten this karate suit. And I put on the karate suit and I'm sitting in my desk and I'm thinking to myself, hey, I wonder if I can do like the guys on karate movies and like focus my energy and become stronger or whatever. So I put my hands together in this weird position and I'm looking down and I'm like humming and shaking. And the girl that's sitting next to me looks at me and is like, dude, you're just weird. But that was me at the time, awkward as heck. But in my elementary school, I was known as the best athlete. That was a big thing for me. I wanted to be. I knew that I was socially awkward. I knew I probably would never really have friends like everybody else, but I could be the best athlete. I could train, I could exercise, and I could be the best athlete. Then, the house that we had moved into, there is speculation as to exactly what happened. The rumor is that a jealous uncle set fire to the house or paid somebody to set fire to the house so that they could kill us. We don't know that that was the case, but somehow with all the fire, the smoke through the flames, my dad was able to break through the windows and get us all out of the house before we died. That was a tough moment for me. And at that point, my dad was kind of absent for a while. Not sure where he was at. My mom kind of took us around. We were homeless for a bit of time. So imagine being 6 or 7 years old and homeless. We would try and stay with the family members that were in the area, but they didn't want us to stay with them for whatever reason. So there was that feeling of rejection and being unwanted that I was experiencing at that very young age. So you take that, you got this kid who's already socially awkward, and then you add on top of that, we're now homeless. And then my other family members, my siblings, my mom, we're going through this as well. And like I said, at this time, I'm not sure what was going on with my dad. My mom managed to find us an apartment. It was in a really rough neighborhood. I remember hearing gunshots all the time, people selling drugs on the corner. It was a very rough place to live. Also during that time, my dad ended up getting arrested. He went to jail. So now, 8-year-old me is not far removed from being homeless, father's incarcerated, and I'm around a lot of negative influences. The reason that I have chosen to work in alternative schools and work in schools where students come from family situations that are similar to mine is because I knew what that experience was like for me, and I want to try and find ways to help those students through those. So back to the story. Now, during this time, I did watch cartoons. Dragon Ball was out, and I would watch that, but I didn't recognize that theme in Dragon Ball just yet. For me, the big thing was Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. That was these Ninja Turtles. They were outcasts. They lived in the sewer, and they were secretly saving the day. It was huge for me when the Ninja Turtle movie came out. And I got to see these guys in live action. But the common theme was always there. Underdog and hero. This was something that always resonated with me. I did end up becoming a bit of a local football star. Not like actual organized football. Football on the side of our building. I would play, and because I was so hard to tackle and I was able to run people over, even people who are a lot bigger, my balance was just amazing. They couldn't, and I'm not bragging because I wasn't good at much else. I just had really good balance. It was hard for them to knock me off my feet. They called me Truck, so my nickname was Truck. Everybody thought that I would go off and be this big-time football player. But no, that wasn't in the cards for me. I had to find a plan B. Apparently, they need you to be able to do other things other than not get tackle. You have to be able to catch or hold on to a ball or follow plays or listen to instructions, all of that weird stuff that I really couldn't do at the time. All right, guys, for now, thanks for watching. Make sure you click like and subscribe if you want to see how this thing ends, how I get to the point where I'm 40 plus years old, balding, but every day I will hop on an exercise bike, I throw on the over-ear headphones, and I watch anime as I'm working out on this exercise bike. How weird is that? I'm an old man with kids and I'm watching cartoons. Well, I'll see you soon, and until next time. All right, guys, welcome back to Crawford Farms Entertainment. I am going to continue this story about how I ended up being this middle-aged dude that watches cartoons and anime. But before we get started, make sure you click that subscribe button, hit the notification icon so that you won't miss any of our anime content. Also, I'm going to show you how I made this avatar that is supposed to look like me. Then if you stick around to the very end, I'm going to show you the number one workout apparatus, number one piece of workout equipment for a dude over 40 who's got a job and kids and everything like that. So make sure you stay tuned to the end, and until then, check this out. All right, I've been trying to use ChatGPT to generate some images to be my new cartoon avatar. And look at this mess. All right, so, well, I mean, I like that one, but you know, that's definitely not me.
The real Mike.
Now, you know you're getting deleted.
I am so sorry.
Then this guy's super skinny. This guy's clearly white. This is supposed to be me. I don't know what I was doing with this, but I was trying to make this one look like me. Did not work. So I'm gonna keep playing with it. I think I'm gonna have to use this one. Y'all don't get mad at me. Actually, no, I'm gonna try one more. And just take the one out of the middle. I'm just use that one. What is that? It's thinking. Yeah, whatever. I'm going with it. We left off with me becoming this kind of a local football star. Not a local football star as in we're playing organized football. No, this was literally just the people in the neighborhood who thought that was pretty good because they had a hard time tackling me. It never translated to any type of football success in real life because, one, it was really expensive to play football in South Florida and we just didn't have the money. And the other thing was I had pretty bad underlying anxiety. So I was nervous about the idea of going out and playing football when everybody thought that I was going to be good. I was terrified that I was going to disappoint everybody. So I'll find ways to sabotage myself. Even if we had somehow found the money for me to play, I would not have played. So the next big life event for me was the birth of my baby brother. So I love my brothers and sisters, and I care for my brothers and sisters, but I never had any type of responsibility to take care of them in the sense of like changing diapers, making sure they ate and things of that nature. Yes, everybody pitched in, but that was one of the responsibilities that I felt that I shouldered in my mind more than everybody else, even though it might not have necessarily been the case. So the birth of my baby brother, it was huge. It was big. I think it prepared me for fatherhood and having my own children. And my little brother, man, yeah, the kid was weird. So me and my other younger brother, we were normal kids. We used to love to play video games and things, but sometimes if my mom had to work, we would be watching my baby brother. I can remember times when we'd be sitting there playing a video game and all of a sudden my foot would feel warm. Right, I have on a sock. That sock would suddenly feel warmer than it should. And I looked down and this little joker was peeing on my foot. I can't remember exactly how old he was, but I know he was old enough to stand up. I know he was old enough to walk. And I know that joker peed on my foot. But those are some of the memories I had of my baby brother. And even though sometimes he drove me nuts, I wouldn't change a moment of it. As time was starting to go on and I was getting older into my teen years, preteen years, my baby brother was my excuse to go and watch cartoons. It gave me an opportunity to watch The Lion King. It also gave me an opportunity to start watching Pokemon because, well, if a 12, 13-year-old kid is going to watch Lion King, it looked kind of lame, kind of weird. But if he's taking his baby brother, he looks very cool doing so. So he was my excuse, my ticket into the movies and to watch cartoons. Now, moving on to middle school. Really crazy time. That struggle to fit in and that social awkwardness was at its peak at this time. It was during this time where I related the most to Bruce Leroy, Goku, anybody who was just basically from another planet than the people that were around him, because I just could not relate. I just did not fit in. So I talked about how my big move from the suburbs in Central Florida down to South Florida into a not so nice neighborhood. I talked about how that was the conception of my anxiety. Well, if that was the conception, middle school was when it went into labor, was born, and came out kicking and screaming. And the way it manifested itself, I would get into fights constantly. I struggled to fit in. I wanted so bad to be that nerdy guy who read comic books and talked about science and played video games and talked about video games and comic books at school. I wanted so bad to be that guy, but that just was not where I grew up at. And so in order to fit in, I had to put on as if I was something else. Like I wasn't that nerd, that goofy comic book reading guy, because I really wanted to fit in. So during this time, the show that I related most to was the X-Men. They were a group of mutants who were just born different. They were born with extraordinary abilities, and the world hated them for it. Now, I knew I didn't have any extraordinary abilities, but I did feel different. I felt like I just didn't fit in with the folks around me. It was mostly because of my anxiety, partially because I was poor, and the people around me, at the very least, they made it seem as if they weren't as poor as I was. Now, as an adult, I realized, yes, they probably ain't have any money either, but they found ways of making it seem as if they did. But I never fit in middle school. I just felt different. I felt out of place. And I knew I was different. I didn't want to just be weird different. I wanted to be extraordinarily different. At one point when I was younger, I had hoped that maybe I'd have some kind of mutation like the X-Men and become super strong or super fast. And eventually I got older and realized that that was not going to happen. So I had to figure out a way to try and set myself apart, to try and be, in my mind, special like I was when I was the best athlete at my elementary school. Even in middle school, I was constantly working out, constantly trying to get stronger. But for whatever reason, I went from being that guy who was the fastest and strongest in his elementary school to all of a sudden, these guys were monsters. They were so much stronger than I was. And I was still gonna fight anyway because I did not care if I lost. My anxiety was such that if I felt threatened, I was going to attack. I had a heightened fight or flight response. And for me, the flight was not there. It was always fight. So I constantly got into trouble. It wasn't until seventh grade when a math teacher came up to me and was like, You constantly get into fights. It seems you like to fight. Maybe you should come out for the wrestling team. So I went out for the wrestling team and I enjoyed it. It was weird though. So when I went out, these guys were older than me. We went out and worked out with the high school team. I was strong enough to lift these guys up and throw them around, but they knew so much more technique than me, they would just wipe the floor with me. But I was hooked. I really enjoyed wrestling. Whenever I could make it, I would go out to practice, and I learned a little bit about wrestling, but it didn't seriously take hold of my life until much later. On my very last day of middle school, we had this stupid day where we were supposed to pick somebody to hit. I don't understand the full reasons for it. So I hit this kid. Apparently it was the wrong kid, and his brother and like this army of guys, I guess they were all wrestlers from the high school, they pulled up and they were ready to attack me for punching this kid. And me, in my defiant attitude, I see all of these guys pull up and they're huge, but in my mind, I can take all of them at the same time. So these guys are up in front of me. They're threatening me like, why'd you hit my brother? We're going to do this, that, this and that to you. You better run and take off. But something in me would not allow me to run. So if this would have been anime, this would have been one of those dramatic moments where the hero digs deep and manages to accomplish something incredible. However, in this situation, I wasn't really the hero. I was kind of the villain. I guess I was being a bully, right? So I did something I shouldn't have done, and I was about to get what I deserved. Fortunately, it didn't play out that way. So I stood my ground. I was ready to fight all of these guys. I probably would have got beaten terribly, but I think the school resource officer showed up and they all ran off, and that was the end of it. So the very next year, I went to that high school, and I went to that high school as a wrestler. Now, my freshman year, I was still watching the X-Men, and then this new show popped up called Wildcats. It's still for something covert action teams. But the premise was there was this group of aliens and alien hybrids who were secretly going around saving the world from the Daemonites. And so at one point, one of the characters in this show did something super cool, and somebody looked at him and said, hey, that's not humanly possible. And the person, this hero, turned around and responded to him, whoever said we were human. I always wanted to find an opportunity to say something like that, to do something amazing and have somebody look at me and be like, man, that's not humanly possible, just so I could respond, well, whoever said I was human. I'm starting to wrestle and I'm training for wrestling. I'm starting to get serious about it, but I cannot win a match. I mean, I'm getting beat badly. I am so far from being able to start as a wrestler, it was ridiculous. I couldn't win to save my life. I would get taken down and pinned sometimes in the span of 30 seconds. I did start as a freshman, but only because the guy that would mop the floor with me, I mean, this guy manhandled me as a freshman. The rumor was that he had gotten arrested for murdering somebody. Years later, I found out that wasn't true. He just moved to another county. But the only reason I started was because of him. And as a starter, I successfully managed to lose every last match that I competed in. All right, so as promised, you guys see I'm covered in sweat right now. The thing that did this to me is my MetaQuest 3 by Facebook or Metaverse, whatever they call themselves now. This thing is awesome. The workout that I just did was through FitXR, but if you really want a cardio burn, try Thrill of the Fight. For me, for that added endurance, I kind of mimic Son Goku and putting weights on myself. That's why you can see this sweat pattern is in kind of a weird shape, because I put on all of these weights and everything to add intensity to the workout. So check it out, MetaQuest 3. It'll have you looking like a psychopath, a nut job, but it's a great workout. Thanks for watching. Make sure you click like and subscribe. Let me see if I can find this mouse. All right, guys, welcome back to Crawford Farms Entertainment. Today, we're gonna continue this story of how I ended up being this middle-aged guy that watches cartoons and anime. And we're also gonna check out my new avatar, and I think this one's a little bit better. So before we get started, make sure you click like and subscribe and hit that notification icon so that you won't miss any of our anime content. Welcome back to Crawford Farms Entertainment. Now, what do you do when you get knocked down? Do you lie there in defeat, call it quits? Or do you get up and try again? Well, of course you get up and try again, right? But what if you get knocked down 9 times in a row? How many times can you tell yourself, I'll get them the next time? Or do you make excuses for yourself or blame the coaches or claim you were cheated? I won't lie. The thought was tempting. But the thing about wrestling is you're facing off against a single opponent wearing nothing but some spandex. You have very few options to blame for a loss. You can't blame the judge. You can't blame your team or your equipment. You learn to own your losses. And I owned all 9 of mine. My hat goes off to any wrestler or athlete who loses and keeps on losing but doesn't give up. Why? Because it builds character, a trait forged in the flames of adversity that never burns hotter than when you're locked in one-to-one combat. I end the season still awkward, still weird, but on top of all of that, I was the laughing stock of the wrestling room. I wish I could say that I ended the season and started training to come back as an ascended Super Saiyan warrior like Goku, but I didn't even know what that was at the time. No, I went back to being me, out of place and not knowing where I fit in. I did get a group of friends that I was hanging out with, but all we did was get into trouble together. We were not good for each other. I remember we all got arrested together, and I played the interrogation as cool as a cucumber while these jokers were freaking out the whole time. And then, when we all get released, they tried to flip the script when we got back to school and made it seem as if I was the one that was terrified. I talked about how I fought in middle school, but I didn't go into detail. It was bad. And that should have been a telltale sign that I had something seriously wrong with me psychologically. I got in a one fight because a kid and I were standing in front of the music room. And I'm not sure why I did it. Maybe I was playing or joking, but I threw a pin and hit him in his back. As soon as I did it, I instantly regretted it and thought to myself, what the heck is wrong with you? You better play it off as if you didn't do it. Well, sure enough, the kid turns around and asks me if I did it. I said, no, I didn't do it. He responded, haha, just stop playing. You're the only one here. Of course you did it. I insisted I didn't do it. Then he said, whatever, stop. And he didn't get to finish his sentence because I ended up punching him in the face. Then my sister tried to give me an S curl. Now this is a different occasion, but my sister tried to give me an S curl. I can't remember what musician had their hair all curly and stuff. And I wanted my hair like that. But instead of curls, this chemical didn't take right and my hair got really straight and spiky. I kind of looked like Bert. I get to school and a few kids start calling me Spike Lee. I fought one of these kids that was making fun of me, then got suspended for 10 days and came back and fought the other one only to get suspended for another 10 days. So when I tell you having these kids clown me and me not end up getting into a fight, it speaks volumes for the person that I was starting to evolve into. I didn't get into a fight with him. I simply stopped associating with him. The wrestling season of my sophomore year started. And at the first match of the season, I was hoping just to make it to the second period of the match. Last year, all of my losses, all 9 of them, may have added up to one full match. We weighed in, and I made weight no problem. I was actually small for my weight. The guy I saw weigh in at my weight class didn't look too mean, so I was thinking, wow, I could possibly make it to the end of this match. I got excited, we warmed up, and I started to think I had a chance. Not a chance of winning, a chance of making it to the end of the match. They sent their captains out to do the coin flip, and after they came back, the coach was excited. He was laying out his plan for how the lineup would go, and he said, hey, Irving, you got their captain, and after you beat him, we will hop on the bus and get the heck out of here. Okay, now I'm thinking two things. One, it was crazy that he was saying we would have to rush out of the gym after we beat these guys. This was our crosstown rival, and things might get crazy after we beat them. But two, did he just say after I win? Who did this guy think he was talking to? Did he not remember what happened to me last year? Plus, this was their captain. Was he just trying to do some kind of weird coach mind game, coaching psychology, and try and trick me into thinking that I had a chance of winning? When they called my match, I stepped out there more nervous than ever before. My legs were shaking. I realized that my hands were shaking too. in my mind, the coach Minus would have wrapped me in this big red bow and pushed me out on the mat because I was definitely going to be a gift of 6 points for this opposing team. The ref blew the whistle and instantly this dude shot in on my legs. It was like in the blink of an eye. I could have crapped myself right then and there, but in that moment I felt something strange, and it wasn't me crapping myself. Try as he might, he could not take me down. Was my mutant power awakening? Of course not. Finally, we ended up going out of bounds with no points scored. Then I looked up at the scoreboard and realized I had made it almost an entire minute. Now, making it a minute for me is huge because all of my matches previously were super quick. I got pinned very quickly in my previous matches. Now, me and my crazy mind, I'm really trying to figure out what's going on here. Was I really getting superpowers? Suddenly, I shot in, and then I took him down. The period ended, and I was winning. For the first time in my high school wrestling career, I was winning. Yo, this was insane. I felt like Bruce Leroy when he got the glow, or Hot Rod from the Transformers when he opened the Matrix of Leadership. As the match went on and I scored takedown after takedown, I realized that I could actually wrestle. Somehow the coach knew it. Then, in a scenario akin to Leroy's flashback,
who is the master?
There is one place that you have not looked, and it is there, only there, that you shall find the master.
To when he was seeing all these people saying, you look like a master to me and all of that, I realized that I could always wrestle in practice, with the exception of the best kids in the room, like the guy used to beat the crap out of me. I did well against most of my teammates. I would just psych myself out before the matches. The match ended and I had more points than my opponent. It wasn't instantly apparent to me what that meant because I had never experienced it before. I had won the match. All it took was someone to believe in me. Now I was starting to have confidence, and I was starting to win more and more matches. As the season progressed, I was even ranked in the county, and I even made captain. Things were going fantastic until I met her. So this girl saw me at practice. She said she thought I was cute and that I was now her new boyfriend. Now, I won't lie, I was still hyper socially awkward, so part of me didn't realize that declining her offer was an option. As I learned more about her, I should have known to stay away. Her ex was like the most popular dude on campus. Staff loved him, the ladies loved him. He was definitely a lot better looking than me. He could drive and was a black belt in karate. That's right, you heard it, he was a black belt in karate. He might have been a hero of mine if not for this scenario. In fact, the dude did this karate demonstration in front of the school at this assembly presentation. I watched that presentation and I was thinking the whole time I could probably whoop this dude's butt. But I didn't realize that the day could possibly come where I might actually have to prove it. I was thinking to myself, this dude is legit a future movie star. And I was just some broke loser who won a few matches. What was this girl thinking? I was constantly trying to find ways out of the relationship. I didn't really like her like that. All right, not my type. I would say I was like Goku and she was like Chi-Chi, but no, this was not that cool. Well, that's it for now. Next time, we'll see how this situation ends up. Will me and Karate Boy throw down? Or do me and Chi-Chi get married? Lord, there better be an option C somewhere. Until next time, make sure you click like and subscribe. Hit the notification icon so that you won't miss the follow-up to this insanity. And until next time, stay awesome, my friends.